I am so excited that The Heretic's Daughter has done as well as it has. This book, The Heretic's Daughter, was my first published book, and it was my first published anything. I had never had so much as an article, a short story, or a poem published before this, and I was on the runway to 50 before I started writing this book. I lived and worked in New York City for almost 20 years, first in commodities and then as a defense contractor for the U.S. Department of Defense. I traveled all through Russia, Kazakhstan, Belarus, converting military plants into civilian use. So basically converting swords to plowshares. And it was fascinating work. But as Tom mentioned, when I went to college at the University of Texas, what I really wanted to do was to write. I wanted to be a writer more than anything. But I wasn't convinced, nor was my family, who was paying for my college education at the time, convinced that I could make a living being a writer. So I left behind, set aside childish things, went to New York, worked, had a wonderful career. I have no regrets. But in the back of my mind, in those long hours in flight, those 18-hour flights to Kazakhstan, these ideas about my family, these stories that were given to me when I was quite young, stayed with me my whole life. I was very fortunate growing up because I first heard about Martha Carrier when I was about 8 years of age. I went with my mother to her mother's house. It was a farm in Pennsylvania. And I remember sitting at my grandmother's dining room table, and my mother and my grandmother were gently gossiping about different family members, talking about past history. And I wasn't paying much attention to them. I was playing with paper dolls or whatever an eight-year-old does. But I heard my grandmother say something about a relative being hanged as a witch. And that immediately caught my attention. I dropped my paper dolls and I said, "What do you mean she was a witch?" And my grandmother said, "Yes, your great, 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 nine times great grandmother was named Martha Carrier, and she was accused as being a witch, and she was hanged. Although she never admitted to being a witch, she very vociferously proclaimed her innocence, but she was hanged." And I said, "Grandmother, was she really a witch?" Because in my childish imagination, being eight and a half, I thought of witches in Halloween terms. I thought of women on broomsticks with pointed hats, flying around at night, wreaking havoc. And I think for myself, as with a lot of little girls, there's this this delight that we could be bad for one day, that we could set aside being the good little girl, the good witch, and be the wicked witch of the West. And so I had all of these things running through my mind when I asked her if Martha was a witch. And she looked at me and said, "Sweetie, there are no such things as witches, merely ferocious women." And that stayed with me, the idea that Martha Carrier was not a witch. She was a much maligned woman, but she had a forceful nature. She was called during the trials by Cotton Mather, one of the leading theologians of his day, the Queen of Hell, not because she was a witch, but because she wouldn't shut up and go away. She opened her mouth to profess her innocence and wouldn't stop talking. So I started asking her questions about the witch trials, and this began a lifelong fascination with the witch trials. And most of us here study the Salem witch trials beginning in middle school through high school. We've read Miller's play, The Crucible, or seen it produced, or seen the movie. We've read about the witch trials, sometimes as just a footnote in our nation's history. We read about the 19 men and women who were hanged as witches, and for perhaps a lot of us, there are lingering doubts as to whether or not these people were confederates of the devil, whether they practiced the black arts, or whether they were just some unfortunate people who were caught up in a frenzy, in a confluence of events that was bigger than all of them. An additional man died during the trials, a man named Giles Corey, who was pressed to death, which was a common British torture to compel someone to testify. Giles Corey was an older man, and he was very stubborn, and he would not either admit to or refuse his guilt, and so to encourage him to speak, they laid heavy stones on his chest, and he would not say anything. And legend says that close to the end of his life, when he was close to dying, the constable leaned down, put his ear close to Giles Corey's mouth, and said, "What do you have to say now, old man?" And Giles Corey said with his last breath, "More weight." So these remarkable, stubborn, flinty New Englanders were really very courageous. What I didn't know, and what a lot of people don't know until I started doing the research, was that 150 men, women, and mostly children were arrested during the Salem witch trials. More than half of the 150 people were under the age of 17, which is really unheard of in the annals of early American history. We had always had witches with us. The Puritans were Western European people who were transplanted from England and Europe, and they brought with them their religious practices, their way of dressing, their way of farming, and their superstitions. There was a long, rich history, macabre history, of tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands, of men and mostly women who were burned at the stake as heretics, or gypsies, Jews, and witches were burned at the stake. Now, in this country, a lot of people mistakenly think that we burned our witches, and we had a kinder, gentler way of dealing with our practitioners of magic. We hanged them. But the courts of law were different then. The courts of law said that if you were brought in, you were guilty until proven innocent. And there was no separation of church and state the way there is now, because the colleges who trained the doctors of law also trained these men as doctors of theology. So to be a lawyer, you had to also be a doctor of theology, because man's law was also God's law. So there was no separation of church and state, and you were guilty until proven innocent. And we had always had isolated instances of people being brought in and hanged for being a witch. And they were primarily women. And they were the usual suspects. And who were the usual suspects? They were women who were often mentally unbalanced. They were crazy. They talked to themselves. They hoarded food. They mumbled. Perhaps they threw oaths and cursed someone, and that person's cow fell sick and died, or they got a boil on their leg that didn't go away. And in the Puritan mind, everything good came from God, and everything bad came from the devil. So these women who were outspoken or crazy or alone and vulnerable were targeted by their neighbors for being witches. And 2 years before the Salem witch trials in 1690, a woman named Bridget Bishop was taken out and hanged because she kept puppets. She kept dolls in her cellar. And she was a brewer of simples. She was an herbalist. She treated the sick and perhaps lost one too many patients. And she was hanged 2 years before the Salem witch trials in Boston. But these were isolated instances. And throughout the hundreds of years since the Salem witch trials, a lot of theories have been offered as to why so many people were accused of being witches. What was this perfect storm of events that came together? Why did it burn so savagely and so burn for such a long period of time? Because the witch trials lasted for more than a year. So what was the cause? And so in doing the research for the book, what was more interesting to me was not just the trials themselves, because I knew that there was plenty of fiction and nonfiction alike that chronicled the witch trials. The more interesting question to me was, why did this happen? How does a group of neighbors who are living fairly peaceably, at least not violently with one another, come to such an abysmal end that an entire village, an entire colony was involved? There were people arrested as far away as Maine during the Salem witch trials. There was a man named George Burroughs who had been a minister in Salem, and they sent men to Maine to arrest him, to bring him back to Salem, to try him for being a witch. So it wasn't just this little tiny village of Salem. It was the entire New England coast that was involved. In modern day, we have read accounts of Germany in the 1930s. And how did generations of people living peaceably together, working together, end up becoming the Holocaust? How did Bosnia become a place where, under Soviet rule, for three generations, was peaceable? Neighbor working with neighbor, attending schools together, and yet within 5 years, it became a bloodbath. What was the underlying mechanism, this mechanism of xenophobic fear and intolerance that could live under the surface and be ready to catch fire and become so destructive? So after 20 years of being in New York, I made a conscious decision to take an early retirement, to move back to my childhood home of Texas, and begin writing the book that became The Heretic's Daughter. Now, I was not associated with any university. I wasn't an academic. I loved history, and I loved historical fiction, and I had to start somewhere, so I started with the research. But I quickly absorbed all of the traditional sources of history, all of the books written about the Salem witch trials, and there were some interesting theories as to why the witch trials took place. One of the theories during the 1960s was that the girls, the accusing girls, had ingested a toxic mold and had gotten ergot poisoning, which is what causes St. Vitus dance, what they call St. Vitus dance in Europe, where there are tremors of the limbs, hallucinations, and people lose their minds, sometimes for weeks at a time. But this explanation wasn't complex enough to explain a village coming apart so dramatically and lasting for so long. So I went to different sources. I went traveled to Massachusetts and Connecticut. I went to historical societies and interviewed local historians. I went to local senior citizen homes where they have local historians there, amateur historians, who had kept the oral tradition within the villages of Connecticut and Massachusetts. I went to the libraries. I went to genealogical societies. I talked to people who lived in the area, who had deep roots there, and started to get an idea of what life must have been like in 17th century New England. Now, I'd gotten a taste of it from my own family, because not only did I hear stories of the Salem witch trials, but I got little anecdotal tales of what life was like for the Carrier family in the late 1600s. And initially, in hearing these stories, I thought that these were just sort of stories that were made up to pass the long winter evenings. One of these stories was that the Carrier family had a cow that was fed pumpkins, and the cow gave golden milk, which was yet one more sign that these people were witches because they had a cow that gave golden milk. My mother, growing up on the farm in Pennsylvania during the Depression, remembered that story that her mother had told her about the Carrier family cow, and they had a milk cow, and she chopped up some autumn pumpkins, salted them, and fed them to the cow. And guess what? The cow gave orange milk. The beta carotene in the pumpkins colored the milk. So she verified that story. So I thought, if that one story was verifiable, perhaps some of the other stories were true too. There were some stories about Martha's children that I incorporated into the book, but one of the more interesting stories was of Martha Carrier's husband, who was named Thomas Carrier. The family legend, the Carrier family legend, said that Thomas Carrier lived to 109, was 7 feet tall, and was one of the executioners of King Charles I of England. Well, surely I thought this was a Paul Bunyan story. During an age where the average height of a man was 5'6", he would literally be a giant among men. Even today, a man 7 feet tall is going to attract a lot of attention. But in doing the research for the book, I found in 1735, which is the year that Thomas Carrier died, the New England Journal reported that a man named Thomas Morgan Carrier, also known as the Welshman, had died at 109, and a few days before his death, he had walked to neighboring Glastonbury with a bag of grain over his back, that he had a full head of hair, that he was erect and walked and was fleet of foot, and that he was so tall that they had to fit two coffins together to bury him. This was reported in the New England Journal, and it was also reported in Benjamin Franklin's paper, Poor Richard. So there was, if he wasn't 7 feet tall, he was tall enough to have had to have two coffins fitted together to bury him. Since the book has been published, I've met many descendants of Thomas and Martha Carrier. And the really remarkable thing is not just that they heard stories about Martha Carrier and her role in the Salem witch trials, but they also heard stories about Thomas Carrier being very tall, living to such a long, ripe old age, and that he was, in fact, one of the executioners of King Charles I of England. Now, that fact may never be supported with historical documents unless a piece of parchment falls out of an ancient tome and it gives the name of the executioner. There's always been doubt among historians as to who the actual executioner was. But a man after a book talk approached me and he said, I'm also a descendant of Thomas and Martha Carrier. I heard the same stories from my grandfather. We were from completely different branches of the family. And he said, my grandfather told me why Thomas was picked as the executioner. And I said, tell me. When Charles I was brought to trial and was committed to the headsman's axe, the hangman, the official hangman and executioner of London, was a man named Brandon, and he refused to cut off the head of the anointed king. He refused. So they had to bring in someone else who was willing to do what no one else was willing to do. Thomas Carrier fought in the English Civil War, but the reason that he was picked was because he was so tall. When they built the platform where the execution was to take place, they built it outside of the banqueting hall at Whitehall Palace. They removed some windows on the second floor, built a scaffolding so that the enormous crowds that gathered could watch the king's head being chopped off. And then the head would be held up so that everyone would see that the tyrant had in fact been killed. The problem was that the scaffolding was so high that the people who'd paid the most money to be there and watch it happen, the noblemen, the titled people, couldn't see what was happening. So they picked a man who was very tall and had an enormous arm reach so that when he held the still dripping head of the king, the people down front who had paid big bucks to see the king's death could in fact see that Charles I, the first king in English history to be killed by a commoner, was presented to them. So I thought, well, that story makes as much sense as anything else. It can't be proven, but it can't be disproven. So that, in and of itself, the fact that through 10 generations that story had been passed down, that the fact that this rumor followed him from town to town to town, that there was enough of physical menace, being a tall man, being a soldier, living amongst a bunch of yeomen, rustic yeomen. He had an aura about him of danger. During the witch trials, when Martha Carrier was arrested, she had 5 children at the time. 4 of her 5 children were arrested with her, along with her, to try to compel her to admit to being a witch. Her 2 oldest sons were tortured. And they, in fact, her children did testify against her. But Martha Carrier never, at any time, admitted to being a witch. And she is more remarkable in that, as far as we know, as far as the historical records show, she is the only person that confronted her judges and said, "Shame on you for listening to a group of hysterical girls." And the reason we know she said this is because the trial transcripts, the verbatim transcripts, are still extant. They are in the Boston Peabody Essex Museum, along with the trial transcripts of her 4 children. We know that her 2 sons were tortured because a letter from prison written by John Putnam, a man made famous by Miller's play, The Crucible. He was one of the principal characters in that play, wrote a letter to the governor and said, "It is shameful that these children are being tortured to testify against their own mother." But Martha Carrier stood her ground. She faced her judges. And I remember my grandmother being so gleeful about the fact that not only was she courageous, not only did she face down her judges and call them to task, but she played with them. And you have to imagine that in this courtroom, these people were brought in front of the entire town. They were positioned standing in front of a group of 3 to 9 magistrates, dressed very soberly in the garb of their office, dressed in black. To the side would have been the accusing girls screaming, having fits, rolling around, pointing. And the evidence that was brought to trial was spectral evidence alone. It was invisible evidence, so that the only people that could see the offending spirits were the accusing girls. The magistrates couldn't see the devils, the townspeople couldn't, but they took the word of a dozen adolescent hysterical girls and arrested and chained 150 people and ground 20 innocent people into the dust. When Martha Carrier stood in front of her judges asked her, "Have you ever seen the devil?" And she said, "The only devil I see are those of you sitting in judgment in front of me." So she gave as good as she got, which was really remarkable for a woman. During a period of time when a woman was completely subject to the paternal society in which she lived, she was subject to her husband, her brothers, her sons. She had no voice, no say, And for a woman of that period of time to be so courageous was truly remarkable. And I remember getting goosebumps reading her words, because the transcripts, which have been reproduced, there's a book written by I've forgotten the name of the authors. I'll think of it in a minute. But it's called Salem Possessed. And they have reproduced the trial transcripts. And it makes for very poignant reading, because you see these men and women appearing in front of the judges. And initially, they will say, I'm not a witch. I'm innocent. But under pressure, as the days and weeks went on, the testimony changes, and you hear them wavering. You see the words, you read the words, and you hear the tone starts to change, where these men and women say, you must be, as my spiritual leader, as the spiritual leader of this village, as this learned man, you must be right. I must be a witch. And the saddest thing was reading this testimony, where these men and women, some of them, a woman such as Rebecca Nurse, who was as close to a living saint as you could possibly imagine a human being to be. She fed the sick, she took in orphans, she was a pillar of society, and yet she was accused of being a witch, along with two of her sisters. And this good woman was accused of being a witch, most probably because she was a landowner. And under the rules of the British court, the victim of witchcraft was compensated by the witch's property, by her land, her chattel, and in some cases, even her children. So Rebecca Nurse was a wealthy landowner, and that was one of the compelling reasons that brought people to trial. But the overarching story of the Salem witch trials was not just one event of greed. It was not just one event of revenge. It was not just one event of superstitious dread. If any one of these circumstances during the Salem witch trials had not occurred, it probably wouldn't have happened the way that it happened. The situation in Salem was ripe for something really terrible to take place. Looking at the court records of Salem Village, which Salem Town is still in existence, but Salem Village, where the witch trials took place, is now called Danvers. And it was a very tiny, poor, but autonomous village that was a village in crisis. They had been for several years without a moral rudder. They didn't have a minister for years because they were too poor to pay a minister. So if you look at the court records, you see people, a very libelous community. They were suing one another. They drank. They gambled. They committed adultery. They swore false testimony against one another. In other words, they were human beings without an anchor, without an ethical or moral anchor, living in the edge of this fomenting wilderness, and they were in crisis. Into this stage walked a man that they hired as the minister of Salem Village, and he was a failed businessman from the Caribbean. His name was Samuel Paris, and he had gone to the Caribbean to try to start a plantation, and he failed miserably. In fact, he failed miserably at just about everything he tried to do. So relatively late in life, he thought, I'll try theology. And he came to Salem because they could afford him. He came on the cheap. And he brought with him from the Caribbean his wife, his daughter, a niece, and two Caribbean Indian slaves, one named John Indian and the other a woman named Tituba. Tituba. And Tituba was also very prominently featured in Arthur Miller's The Play, The Crucible. I bring up his play so often, because that play was really the benchmark in the arts and letters about social hysteria. And of course, he had a political agenda. He was writing about the McCarthy era communist scare witch trials. So he had a very specific modern parallel that he was drawing. But he did his research well, and he realized that this Caribbean Indian slave, Tituba, was sort of the focal point that started the Salem witch trials. She was a Christianized woman, but her ancestry was from Africa. She believed in magic and in the invisible world. By birthright, probably from mother to daughter would have been passed on the right and the belief in the invisible world, the belief in spirits, the belief in magic, the belief in foretelling the future. So even though she was Christianized, she held very tight to this belief in magic. Of course, in a Puritan tradition, magic was the work of the devil, and at best, you were beaten and jailed, and at worst, you were hanged. So she would have kept this very quiet. She came to this cold, forbidding, flinty place and was the servant of Reverend Paris. And as Reverend Paris went out into the community to talk to his troubled flock, into his home, ostensibly for religious instruction, came a dozen adolescent girls. And any of you who've raised teenage daughters, who have been a teenage daughter, know that the idea, the modern idea of the gossip girl or the mean girl is nothing new, because there's nothing more terrifying than a group of adolescent girls who are not being watched carefully enough. So they came into the home to learn the Bible. The Puritan homes were very literate homes. They were much more, the rate of literacy was much higher than their European counterparts, because it was believed to save your immortal soul, you need to read the Bible. So these girls, aging in range from 9 to about 17, came into Reverend Paris's home, started reading the Bible, and these girls were bored unto death. If it was fun, it was sinful. And remember, women had no say, but adolescent girls were the lowest of the low. They were to be seen and not heard. When a girl was 9 years old, she was sent out of her home to learn to work. Boys went out of their home too, but a girl's world was circumscribed by hearth and home. She learned how to midwife, she learned how to cook, she learned how to be a proper helpmate to her husband, but of course she was the beginning of sin. She was Eve's daughter and was therefore the receptacle of everything that was bad. So these girls, who had no natural outlet, are put alone with Tituba. Tituba, who knew magic. Tituba, who was this beautiful, exotic woman who had lived a life none of these girls could even imagine. And at some point during the winter of 1691, the girls started to ask Tituba to do some simple magic for them. And it was probably harmless, what we would consider harmless. Tituba, who am I going to marry? How many children am I going to have? Will I live past childbirth? And Tituba, during that cold winter, was convinced or compelled to start doing magic, and at some point they were caught. Reverend Paris comes home, he discovers them doing magic, and the girls, to avoid being punished and to do what adolescents are likely to do in a situation like that, they pointed to Tituba and said, "She made us do it. She bewitched us. She's the instrument of the devil." So Tituba is arrested, she's beaten, she's thrown in prison, and she starts naming names. And who does she name? Women who were already suspected of being witches. Women who were crazy, women who were unpleasant, or women like Martha, who it was well documented had already had quite a few arguments with her neighbors. She argued about boundary disputes. She argued about lost and straying livestock. And so she had already appeared in the town records as being a very staunch and vocal supporter of her family. So she was one of the first to be accused of being a witch. Now, a few women, three, four, five women, would have been hanged, and then it would have been forgotten, except for one person who was the driving force behind the witch trials and who saw witches everywhere, and that was Cotton Mather. Cotton Mather was the son of an even more famous theologian named Increase Mather, who began the Congregational Church in Boston. He was famous all over Europe for his sermons, for his rigorous rooting out of evil wherever he found it. He started one of the first temperance societies in Boston to stamp out the evils of the sailors coming into port and drinking, and he was a giant. And Cotton Mather was a very ambitious young man and needed to fill very large shoes, and he needed something to make a name for himself. And he received a letter from one of his theologian colleagues from this little backwoods nowhere called Salem Village that witchcraft was afoot. He came to Salem Village and he said, yes, in fact, these girls are bewitched. And these girls realized they went from having no say, no power in the community at all, to having the power of life and death over the people in their village. So not only did they start accusing men and women who were adults, but they started settling old scores. They started accusing girls their own age, and they were put in prison. Neighboring towns got caught up in the hysteria too, and they would borrow the girls, and they'd take them by wagon into neighboring towns such as Topsfield and Ipswich and Beverly, and they'd say, point out our witches. And they'd say, her and her and him. And those people would be arrested. The jail in Salem was meant for a dozen, 16, 20 at most, drunkards, wife abandoners, and very soon the jails overflowed. So what did they do? They started putting people in attics and in cellars and in outhouses, and they were shackled, manacled to the floor of their prison, children as young as 4 years of age. The youngest child accused of witchcraft was a girl named Dorcas Good, who was 4 years old. Her manacles would have weighed between 7 and 14 pounds, which would have been about a third of her body weight. Dorcas Good was in prison when her mother was dragged from the cell and hanged by the neck until dead, and legend said that Dorcas went mad, that she went crazy from this early experience and spent her life begging in the streets because this experience unseated her mind so terribly. The second youngest child to be arrested was Martha Carrier's daughter, Sarah. Sarah was only 6 years old when she was arrested. Sarah and her three brothers were arrested. The two oldest were tortured. Sarah was brought in front of her judges, and the transcript is really heartbreaking because this little child, 6 years old, is brought in front of this panel of very austere judges who believe that her mother is a witch and that she is a witch also. And when they ask her how she was made a witch, she says in her testimony, my mother made me a witch. And when they ask her, how were you made a witch? She said, my mother placed my hand on the red book. And when I read that, the hairs on the back of my neck stood up, because I'd done enough research to know that in Puritan homes, these literate homes, they kept Bibles, they kept religious tracts, sermons by Jonathan Edwards, whose most famous sermon was Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. The Puritan God was an angry, vengeful God. They would have read sermons by Increase and Cotton Mather, and they would have been bound in very plain leather, black or brown leather, or parchment bound, not red leather. Red was the color of the devil. Where would a six-year-old Puritan child have seen a book bound in red leather? And it dawned on me that she saw a red book somewhere. And that became the inspiration in the book to embed the story of the carriers, that there was, in fact, a red book, that there had been a red book. And in doing the research and beginning to write, I decided to make the narrator of the story Sarah Carrier. And it's through her eyes that we see the growing hysteria. We see neighbor turning against neighbor. We see Cotton Mather coming to the trials. We see the miscarriage of judgment and the hysteria and the venal, malicious gossip that went along with it. I made Sarah, the fictional Sarah, a little bit older because I thought a six-year-old child was very young. It would make a more compelling narrator to make Sarah 9. But I also picked 9 years of age because that was the age of childhood's end in a Puritan home. At 9 years of age, a child was sent out of the home, as I talked about a little earlier, to learn a useful craft. But there was also another reason for it, because the Puritans believed that life was to be endured and your reward came after death, and that if a child stayed in their own home, they would be spoiled, they would be coddled, and they would be weakened to the vagaries of life. So they were sent away to a stranger's home. And one of the most poignant letters that I read in doing the research was a minister writing to a fellow theologian. And he writes in his letter, "I sent my Betty away today. And she cried and begged me to stay. But I knew it was for the good of her immortal soul. So I sent her away." So I've made the fictional narrator a little bit older. And it's through her eyes that we see the growing hysteria. But the Salem witch trials in the book, sort of, it's an important part of the book, but it's the backstory. At heart, the book is a coming-of-age story. At heart, the book is a coming-of-age story, a story of struggle between a mother and a daughter. All of us at one time, all of the women here, were at one time daughters. And for a lot of us, at one point in our lives, the worst thing that anybody could say to us was, "You are just like your mother." The idea, the confrontation, the standing in opposition to our mothers is what gives us our sense of identity. It's what gives us our strength. And it is oftentimes much later in life that we say, "Ah, I get it. Now I understand. I understand what my mother was talking about. Her unyielding, difficult nature was for my good. Her pathos, her suffering made her unyielding. Her engagement in life caused her to put up barriers or caused her to be too needy and too needful." But it's not until we've lived life ourselves that we see this. So I thought that this was a universal story. It was a story about generations, about the oral tradition of passing down from mother to daughter to granddaughter, this tradition of family history, the pride of place, the pride of ethnic background, the pride of suffering and sacrifice. And this is a universal story. The Heretic's Daughter today is being published in 15 countries, including China, Turkey, Poland, Romania, Western European countries, Italy, Brazil. And I think no one was more surprised than I was to have found the book translated into different languages, because quintessentially it's an American story. It's a story of our American history and the process, the becoming, the unique human being that the American psyche is. And it was formed, it was forged within the Puritan tradition, but it was also strengthened through surviving in the wilderness. So I always thought of it as an American story. But to my surprise and delight, the story of mother and daughter conflict is universal. The story of the mechanics of repression are the same world over. Regardless of what you call it, a group of people refusing to engage in the civilized discourse, who seeks to suppress the weakest members of society, who are usually women and children, who do not engage in due process of law, who do not allow freedom of speech, freedom of expression. Those mechanics of repression and danger to its citizens are the same. So all through Western Europe now, there's a lot of fearfulness about groups of people who do not engage in this civilized process, the civilized discourse. And so this resonated for a lot of people. And I think also it was a recognition that history is important and oral history is really important. Oftentimes, we find that when the storyteller is gone, so is the story. And it's so important to pass that story on, and very often the receptacles, the vehicles of those family stories are the women. The women who pass down the stories of aunts and uncles and grandparents, people who fled Europe, who fled the pogroms, people who fled from the Holocaust, people whose roots were very deep in New England, but who survived Indian raids and smallpox and childbirth, and those women that raised children and survived and thrived. All of Martha's children survived. All five of her children survived. And at Thomas Carrier's death at 109, he had 38 grandchildren. At 70 years of age, he went from Massachusetts to Connecticut. He built three homes and started a blacksmith forge and kept his family together. He never abandoned them. He never appears one time in the witch trials, which in and of itself is quite unique. They left him alone, but he never abandoned his family and he never married again, which was very unusual. It was almost compensatory that people married after being widowed. They had to marry or be thought a scandal. Thomas Carrier never married again. When his wife died, he kept his family together, he provided for them, but he died a bachelor. So the story of the heretic's daughter is a love letter to my family. It's a story about the bravery of the Puritans, their courage, not just the Carrier family, but all of the New Englanders who survived. The second book, which is a prequel to The Heretic's Daughter, is called The Wolves of Andover. It will be released in November, and it chronicles the life of Thomas Carrier. It follows his life through the English Civil War, which gave us the seeds of the American Revolution. The ideals of equal rights for men and women took root in the leveler cause during the English Civil War, over 100 years before we fought the American Revolution. Thomas Carrier fought for Cromwell during the English Civil War. It chronicles the events leading up to the death of King Charles I and the flight of the regicides over to the New World. And Charles II, Charles I's son, who came to the throne after Cromwell died, sent two major expeditions to New England to capture and kill the men responsible for killing his father. Not one man was caught. Every one of the colonists hid and gave aid to the regicides, who hid in plain sight. So even in the 1660s, the colonists were already thumbing their nose at the royalists, saying, these people fought for freedom, we're going to provide for them. So that is the story in broad brushstrokes of the Heretic's Daughter.